few points of JSON parser and the code that you'll be using for subsequent checkpoints as well. So at any point, if you have questions, please speak up. Otherwise, if I'm going too slowly, also please speak up as well. So, okay, checkpoint zero is basically there for the sole purpose of making sure that all of your infrastructure works, that you can submit through Git, that there's not a problem with your public keys, that you basically have all of the pieces in place. Over the course of today's lecture, if you piece together all of the little snippets of code that I'm talking about, you'll probably be able to assemble a working checkpoint zero implementation just from the code that I'm giving you today. This is not meant to be a challenge, this is mainly meant to be a way to make sure that all of your infrastructure is working. So, all right, let's get to it. I want to cover four basic parts of this assignment today, and time permitting, I'll also start talking about indexing, which I normally had scheduled for next class. But four things that I want to talk about in terms of the project. I want to briefly touch on how CCJSQL Parser, the parser class, works. I'm going to try and dispel some of the confusion that's surrounding SQL ASTs. Hopefully, there's not as much confusion this year, at least on Piazza so far. So fingers crossed you guys are getting it. But I'll cover a few things there. I want to talk a little bit about how select statements are structured, and I want to talk a little bit about create table statements as well. Actually, before I get into any of this, is anyone running into trouble with checkpoint zero? Does anyone have a specific question that I can answer or tailor my later discussion points? So everyone's able to get it working. Yes. You weren't able to. Okay, so Git, there's a weird bug that came up sometime, a brand new bug that someone managed to discover, and it has been causing a periodic interruption of new key uploading. So if you get either Git tells you that it needs a password, or Git tells you that it needs a that you don't have access to the repository that you're looking up, please email me. I need to pick the submission system in a specific way, and that should hopefully make it work. Apologies for this. Literally came up a few days ago. So email me. And anyone else who gets a please enter your password error, please email me and include your group ID, include your UBIT as well. That'll be under email. Any other questions? I like that. That was easy. All right. Great. So, CCJSQL parser. So a parser is basically a component of any programming language that goes from a string, a text file, to something more structured that you can actually work with in a computer program. If I give you the string select star from R, you can't generally work with that without trying to break it apart into its component pieces. And a parser is basically a fancy way of doing that. Now, CCJSQL Parser parses SQL, and it does so, you essentially give it a source of data to read from, and then you repeatedly call this function called statement, and what this function does is it goes to the next, basically it tries to read a statement from the string that you give it, or from the input source that you give it, and it returns that statement if it exists, or it returns null if there's nothing else to read. The example that's on the Checkpoint Zero webpage uses a string reader, but I want to emphasize a point that you can use any sort sort of reader or input stream as an argument to CCJ SQL parser. So for the bulk of your projects, you can just pass it system.in, and it'll just keep reading SQL statements off of that stream. Now, again, for this particular project, this is a little bit overkill, but in general, the pattern that generally appears in student submissions looks a little bit like this. You initialize the parser with system.in, and then you keep reading statements off of the input stream one at a time, and just keep reading them until the input stream ends. So these statement objects, you're going to have to do something with them, but basically the general structure tends to end up looking something like this. Questions so far? So what is a statement? A statement is part of what's called an abstract syntax tree. And this is essentially a representation of the string, the program, or the expression that you're being asked to evaluate. So statement, there's a number, in JSQL parser, all of the abstract syntax trees are basically, there are two parts to them. There's an interface, like for example statement, that corresponds the type of thing that appears in the tree. And then there's specific instances of that thing. So for example, a select statement is a type of statement. Create table is a type of statement. And when you call parser.statement, what you get back is essentially one of these statement objects. There's a ton of other types of these interfaces. Select body from item, select item, expression. We'll get into expressions a little bit later in the course. But the first couple, the first few are things that you'll encounter even in, well, everything except for select item, you kind of won't encounter it. The first assignment, but the first three you'll already encounter in checkpoint zero. So each of these, basically, if you think of the expression select star from table name, that kind of forms a tree. So you've got the select object is kind of the root, and then branching off from that are different bits and pieces of that structure. If you think of algebra, 1 plus 1 kind of forms a tree with plus at the root and 1 as the two leaves. Parenthesization in arithmetic follows the same basic pattern. You get kind of a tree structure building up. So let's see. So you got statements, you got select bodies, which represent the actual contents, the chewy nougat center of a select statement. From items represents sources that you can read data from. For now, we're just using table, but join and subselect will show up later on in the term as well. Select item is essentially what appears immediately after the keyword select. So star, table columns, and you can get a couple of other types of expressions. Well, and finally, expression represents any arithmetic, Boolean, Harrison type, questions so far? So there's a couple of different ways of interacting with abstract trees. The big problem, or the big source of confusion that I see in a lot of people is, how do you unwrap a node in an abstract syntax tree? So typically you know what type the node has, but getting the contents out of it requires you to figure out what type the object has. And an anti-pattern that I often see is converting the extracted statement into a string. Please don't do this. If you feel the urge, to take a statement or any of those other objects that I gave you before and convert it into a string, fight that urge. I implore you, fight that urge. Instead, what you should be doing is trying to figure out what type the object has. Now, JSQL parser has this whole spiel with visitors. Those are super annoying to use, in my opinion. If you want to dig into how they work, great. But what I would recommend using is Java's instance of operator. So you're going to see this pattern basically show up very frequently in your code, where you have some sort of abstract syntax tree node, in this case statement, and you want to do something slightly different depending on what type of node it is. So in this case, you can read a statement off of the command line, and it can be one of several different types of statement: a select statement, a create table statement, a number of different types of statements. Instance of will tell you which type it is. If statement is an instance of select, you do something as if it were select. Same thing with create table, and I think those are the only two we're going to be using this term. Probably you won't see any of the others, but questions so far? Into the one that's relevant for checkpoint zero, select statements. Select is actually a wrapper class because typically select statements actually include a little bit more information than just the phrase select blah from blah. There's with clauses, there's other stuff that for this project, for the course of the term, are not immediately relevant, but they're there if you want to deal with them. The one thing that you will need from the select statement is a body. This is basically what represents the actual select statement itself, select blah from blah. And this has the type select body, which is itself a type of abstract syntax tree node. So you're gonna have to tease that apart as well, figure out, excuse me, what type the select body is. And there can be two types. You can have plain selects, which just represents plain selects, or you can have unions, which represent a union of plain selects, or a list of plain selects that get unioned together. So in this particular case, in the case of checkpoint zero, you're only going to be working with plain selects. So you can you should test to see if it's a plain select, but you don't need to handle the union case just yet. So if it's an instance of plain select, great, you do something with it, and that something is basically outlined in checkpoint zero. So plain select is where you're going to spend most of your time interacting with JSQL parser. And while this is not a valid SQL query, it basically illustrates every single part of a plain select. So you have a select from where, blah, blah, blah. Every single part of this query, everything in square brackets here, corresponds to one method or one class variable in the plain select. So fields, every single one of those things in brackets has one method that shows up in the plain select class. So essentially, if you're looking to find a particular field of a select statement, you get out the plain select object, and then you dive in and find the particular method that corresponds to what you're looking for. Questions? Great. All right. Now these are not strictly speaking required for checkpoint zero. But while we're on the topic, select items come in three basic flavors. You've got select star, you've got select table name dot star, and you've got select and an expression. We're opening select an expression with an alias attached to it. Once again, you have this abstract tree node, abstract syntax tree pattern, where select item is a general class of things, and you're going to need to use instance of to figure out which class of or which specific type you have. Yes?
My question is regarding previous slides. So you just spoke about select, and there is a syntax which, you put an if loop for the select statement, right? Or a create statement. So if our syntax is something like select star into, then it automatically creates a new table. So which loop should it go into? Which condition should it go into?
Is this what you're asking?
Yeah, so there are two conditions, like the first condition is for select statement and the second one is for create table.
Yep.
So let's say my syntax is something like select star into.
Okay.
And the into creates a new table.
I actually don't think that... okay, so that's a great question. How does it deal with select star into, which, as a side effect, creates a new table?
Right.
So first, I'm not 100% certain whether a JSON parser even supports into. If it does, it would show up as a select statement. My general response for these sorts of things, try it out. Run the code, feed a select statement into it, and, see what type it has. Print it out, maybe not print it out because that'll just generate the script representation, but do an instance of, see what comes out. So in this case, this corresponds specifically to things that start with select and things that start with create. Okay, select items. Alright, so we also mentioned these expression objects. I'll just vaguely mention this. So you've got where clause, the where clause, the having clause, every instance of select expression item, and order by, all contain within them an expression object. I'm not going to get into these this week, but just to give you a general sense of this is basically any arithmetic expression. You have functions, you have addition, subtraction, multiplication, etc., comparisons, basically any expression that evaluates to a single or can be evaluated to a single value shows up as an expression. Okay, so this is everything that, in my opinion, you need to know for checkpoint zero, but my opinion is less useful here than your opinion. What else do you need to know? Or what else do you feel you need to know? Or have I covered everything? Tonight, everyone's going to submit a work in checkpoint zero. Thursday night? Yeah?
Will the input of multiple select statements or the...
Will there be input of multiple select statements? For checkpoint zero, you don't have to worry about that. For checkpoint one, you will be given a sequence of statements, not just one. Does that address your question? Yeah?
Okay, so example of
Could I give an example of the output of checkpoint one? Do you mean checkpoint zero or checkpoint? Okay, just making sure. That's one of the reasons I repeat the question. I'm not trying to I'm not being condescending. I'm just making sure that I understand you correctly, and also so that it gets recorded properly. Okay, so can I give you an example of the output of checkpoints? So let me do this on here. So you're actually getting data in, there is actual data in the files. So let me first kind of do a quick overview of the file systems work. So you basically, your code gets put into a directory, and that directory also has a subdirectory called data. And in data, you're also going to have another file. Several files that have the form file name .csv. And basically we pick file name from a list of random ones. So you got a couple of those. Alright, so basically what happens is we run code like this. Basically, well, I'm oversimplifying a little bit. The test harness doesn't quite do this, but for all intents and purposes, we basically send the string select star from, and then a random word, randomly selected word, we pipe that into your code. So it'll show up in system. Send the string select star from file name into your we pipe that into your Java code so it'll show up in system.in. And when you do this, basically what we expect to see as output is everything that shows up in file. Just take whatever shows up in that file, that you should print out to the command line. So I forget exactly how that gets generated, but it's essentially a random type separated value data set. So you might get red, 3, 9, 6, 5. Whatever's in that file out. Does that address your question?
one is graded, that would be like, no more tests again.
Yeah, no, once, whatever your, when you hit 5 points, good, you're done. You move on to checkpoint one, which we'll introduce early next week. Yeah. No. Well, okay. You can. So the question is, can you pick whatever name you want for your packet, for your Java package? So you can put your code wherever you like, but the class that gets run is called. It is the class main in the package dubstep. Other than that one class, you can use whatever you like, but that one class has to be. Does that address your question? Anything else? All right, let's take a quick 5 minute break. Be back here at 105. Yeah. Be back here at 105 and actually 103. Back here at 103, and if you have any other questions that you prefer to ask me directly, you know, I'm here.
Be careful.
Okay. You say so.
So this is exactly the problem that he was talking about. Yeah, so send him an email, and he'll just get the system to recognize the property. Yeah, so it's the problem is that your public key is not being recognized by the server. So did you upload did you upload your public key?
One of my teammates did.
Yeah.
So I did. Both of us are using different keys basically. So here's my key. This I do have it in my SSH. I do have it uploaded. It shows that it's uploaded.
Okay. Yeah, so send him an email and help.
All right. Did it work for one of my team?
Probably just depends on what time you happen to submit the key.
The system is not in the mood, is it?
Yeah.
question. Just as a heads up, so there is an official version of JSQL parser which hasn't been updated in almost a decade now. We're not using that one. There's a number of reasons that it's horrible. Our fork of JSQL parser is slightly better. It's still got its limitations, but make sure that when you download JSQL parser, you're grabbing the one from the checkpoint zero, the checkpoint zero instructions, or from the course webpage. Don't go with the one that you can find on the official JSQL parser website. Sorry. Actually, that's all right. So let's move on. So I warned you that the start of I warned you last class that by the end of the term you're going to get sick of this 5 lines of or 4 lines of code. We're going to come back to it today. So in the last class, we kind of established this idea of this 5 lines of code roughly corresponding to a sort of workflow, where we kind of start with the base CSV file. We read the data in, then we filter all of the records that don't match the conditions that we're looking for. In this case, we're looking for specific people with specific ranks and people with specific ages. And we print out all of the records that correspond to a specific, all of the names that correspond to the records that match the predicate that we were looking for. So specifically, we're looking for rows of the CSV file where the rank is not Ensign and the rank, and the age is greater than 25. So in the last class, we kind of focused mostly on. On this step, trying to optimize the data representation in a way that would allow us to read things out more quickly and more efficiently. Today, we're going to take that a step higher, and we're going to start talking about how we optimize the data representation in a way that allows us to run that filter operation way faster. So let's brainstorm a little. What can we do if we know that we are specifically looking for rank and age? Or let's simplify the problem a little. We thought that age was the best thing to test for first. So let's say that we are specifically looking for records that match this predicate on age. What can we do to make things faster? This came up last class, so I know someone. Yeah. Sort the data. How does that help? So let's start in the very middle. Let's say we start right here. 21 is less than 25, right? We have to go hired. 21, so let's say go here. 38 is greater than 25, so we go here. And now we know that the separator, that only the records greater than, starting at this point, are the records that we care about. Okay, great start. So we've essentially eliminated the need to even look at these records. And in general, if we have a million different records, then we, in general, will only need to touch log n of those records. So, okay, what is that? So, great, we have a way to recover a bunch of records without touching almost all of the records in this range where we don't actually need to return those records. Okay, so this is kind of a nice idea. I like the direction. What are some limitations? What is this? What problems might you run into with this particular implementation? Okay, so you have to sort all of the data up front. So there's a fairly high upfront cost, and there's certain cases where you might not actually want to put to pay that upfront. Good observation. We will actually get back to that hopefully towards the end of the term when we start talking about adaptive data structures. Adding new data. Okay, so adding data to a sorted array can be a little bit challenging. If we have time, we'll be getting to that today. If not, that's the first thing we cover next class. Yeah? You can only sort by one field at a time. Another good point, and we're going to get to that. I'm actually at this point looking for a few even more fundamental, like low-level details here. So, here's a question. How do we know where the middle record starts? So we need to know the total records? What do you mean by that? Okay, so somewhere we need to record how many records there are total, so we can figure out what the ordinal position of the middle record is. We know we have a million records. We can then figure out that we need to go to the 500,000th record to start our binary search. But how do we know where the 500,000th record is? We need to index it. What do you mean by that? Serial number. What do you mean by having serial numbers? So we need some primary key. So remember one thing that I tried to emphasize last class. This entire thing is one big blob of memory. You can think of it as either being memory in RAM, or maybe it's on disk. But this is basically one big old blob of memory. The way that you access this is you say, give me byte number 523, or give me byte 5,256. So I see where you're going with that. If you have some sort of key, then you can figure out where the data is. But that assumes that you have some mapping from keys to positions, to look. To actual memory locations where that data lives. Hold on to that thought. Maybe about 10 minutes. Okay. Okay, so one strategy we talked about last time was using fixed length records. So we can, if we know that every record takes up exactly 50 bytes and we're looking for record number 100,000, we know that is located at byte, turn my math here, 5 million. Okay, so that's one strategy. Another strategy that we didn't touch on last week, but that's going to come up a lot today and in the next lecture, is to actually break this whole space up into predictable chunks of data. So let's say you take this whole space, break it up into predictably sized chunks of data, and just kind of start filling in records. And if you hit, if you run out of space within one of these chunks, you just ignore that memory. There's a few different strategies for filling these in, organizing them. They're in the optional textbook, but we're going to assume, at least for the moment, that what we really care about is that we just know that in each of these chunks, there's a bunch of records, and we know where the chunk boundaries are. So even if we don't have necessarily fixed size records, we can still organize the data in a way that allows us to figure out where the start of an arbitrary record is. Okay, question so far? Length records. What else? The limited records. And what was the third one? Okay, so having a kind of directory header or footer in the record. So in a sense, we can do exactly the same thing here. We can have the records can be fixed length. Great. That actually solves the chunking problem also, because you know that exactly how many records can fit in a chunk of size here appropriately. You can use delimiters. So after each chunk, you put in a new line character. Basically, treat each of these as kind of a mini CSV file. Or you can put a little directory either at the start or the end of the chunk saying where the start of each record is. So that kind of strategy can be applied recursively, be applied at each level of the structure. Okay, so that addressed one problem we had, finding the start of the middle record. If we have fixed length records, great. If we don't have fixed length records, we can still kind of organize things into chunks of data. Now, coincidentally, these chunks also play another interesting role. So if you're talking about hard disks and going moving data from hard disks to RAM, they already that type of access already happens in terms of chunks. Those chunks, in the case of hard disks, are called pages. And if you want to read a particular byte from a hard disk, what you do is you say, give me the page that byte is located on. And if we make sure that each page or each of these chunks corresponds roughly to one page, then we already have this natural alignment between this structure and what the disk is already providing us with. Now, you know, hard disks are passe. I know someone brought up the SSDs being way better. SSDs do exactly the same thing. Chunk of data in at a time. And lest you say that RAM is the wave of the future, that everything is RAM in-memory databases are super awesome, and we should be using in-memory databases for everything, then RAM also works this way. You've got cache lines. So cache lines are basically chunks of memory that get read into cache all at the same time. So this type of pattern, this type of chunking pattern, actually provides this additional benefit that it works very nicely with existing infrastructure for transferring data between levels of the memory. Questions? That's a good point. So you can do, so the observation was that you can chunk the data all you want, but eventually you're going to have to do a binary search within a chunk. So that's a good observation. If the records are fixed size, great. If another strategy that came up was using a directory to kind of organize where each record starts. So let's zoom in on one of these chunks. So we can do one of several different things. Either the records are all fixed size, in which case we know where each record starts. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So this record starts at 3 times the size, 2 times the size, 1 times the size, and so forth. We could also kind of have a little bit of a header here that says, warn me when I do that. I'll try and find a better way to do word notes in a way that I can take back and not force you to go through the video to find the notes. But for now, yell at me if they go off the page. So even if the records themselves aren't fixed size, then just like we had this idea of having a directory header that tells us where each field starts, we can have a directory header that tells us where each record starts. So this record is here, this guy is here, this guy is here, this guy is here. We know that that each of these is basically one integer large, so we can find position of the directory pointer that we're looking for, and follow it to figure out where the log starts. For a couple of different reasons that y'all can discuss on Piazza if you'd like, this directory actually typically is located at the end of the page rather than the beginning. And I'm curious to see if anyone can come up with some good reasons for doing that. So this usually lives actually at the end. And then we can do delimiters, in which case you still, binary search doesn't really work, but you're working with a relatively small amount of data, so maybe you don't want to do binary search in the first place. A good question. Okay. Good. So, all right. So given that each chunk corresponds to one kind of movement of memory in the memory hierarchy, does anyone see another problem that might arise when doing binary search? Let me ask you again. Each time you're looking at a record, you have to load a whole other page. Good. So, well, actually, not good. Good answer, bad behavior. In general, you're going to load log n pages of data. And every I.O., remember from last class, the most expensive thing that we end up doing, 90% of databases is built around reducing the amount of data that you have to move around between different parts of the country. You want to load as few pages as possible. So if we have to load log n pages in order to find the record that we're looking for, or log n cache lines, or log n pages on an SSD, that is a ton of work just to find one record. Better than a full scan, granted, but we can do better. Or at least I think we might be able to do better. Ideas? Break up the entire space, and we kind of put these, so we recorded to ourselves a little bit of a note that says page 1 contains only records between 1 and 23, page 2 contains records between 23 and 59, and so forth. And recording this information takes up a ton less space than the entire data stored in the page. So if we have essentially another page sitting somewhere up in the ether, we can basically say, okay, you know, if you're looking for records between 1 and 23, then go to page number 1. If you're looking for records between 23 and 59, go to page number 2. If you're looking for records between 59 and 102, then you go to page 3. Questions? Comments? Yeah? So the comment was, we could even further make these pages more compact if, rather than storing the full record here, all we stored was the attribute we were looking for and some sort of unique identifier for each primary key. That's a great observation. I think we will, there's a little bit of a trade-off, and that deserves a much deeper discussion than I'd like to. I basically like to finish this thought, but you guys are really good at coming up with good ideas, more good ideas than I can justifiably talk about in a linear manner. I'd love to be able to kind of like fork myself into lots of different sub-processes and talk about. We're going to have to talk about them each one at a time, but I want you to hold on to that observation because it's super important. Good. Yeah? I think you guys are setting up for a grudge match between two different strategies, and each of you have excellent points, or I suspect that each of you have excellent points. We will get to that either later today, or that is the... Well, I said updates might be the first thing. The list is growing. Well, we will get to all of it, I swear. We have 3 days to talk about indexes. All right, so great observation. So, all right, we've got this structure here. We have, it takes a lot less space to store kind of page boundaries or information telling us what data shows up on each page. Does anyone anticipate a problem, possibly? Yeah. This page. so this allows us to do our binary search within this one page. We just load this one page into memory. We load this one page into memory and do our binary search here. Then we load whichever page happens to correspond to the data that we're looking for. So we end up loading two pages into memory for every single request. Well, that's a pretty drastic improvement over login constant, way better than login. And since this page is going to be accessed pretty continuously, we might as well just keep it in RAM all the time and save ourselves the trouble. But does anyone see a problem? So keeping in mind that we don't get to control the page size. We need another similar page for lower granularity, right? What do you mean by that?
You need another page to make it be able to start it within one page. So the binary search from within one block.
So, oh, you need some way of doing a binary search within the block?
Yeah.
Well, okay, I mean, we talked about doing the directories from so that. We store that within the one within the same page. That we'd still need to load the one page in, but we wouldn't need to repeatedly search. Is that what you're getting at, or I'm not sure I follow?
Yeah. So we have one page describing the boundaries of this log of data.
Mm-hmm. So we have
and
to load.
We'll have another
okay.
page. Yeah. So we'll have another page which describes the boundary within one subsection.
What advantage would that we get from that? Oh, I see. So you'd still need to load this data page in. Okay. Yeah, you gotta load two pages in. Well, two pages is still way better than log n. Can we do better?
No, I mean, my question is how do we go from, so suppose we know that the data which we're looking for lies between 23 and 59, so
okay.
second block.
So then we load this page in, and then you said 23 and 59?
Yeah.
So then we have to load this page in.
Yeah. So how do we go more deeper? I mean, how do we find the data within that page?
Well, so the. So within one of those pages, we're going to have either some, we're going to have some way of doing a binary search. Once the page is in memory, we have at least a few ways that we can do a binary search over the data once it's in memory or once it's in cache. Basically, once it's loaded off of the slower form of media and into the faster form. So what happens, let me ask you this, what happens when what happens when this one page fills up? I mean, you know, on a hard disk, we're talking about maybe 4 kilobytes per page. HDFS goes about a meg per page. But in each case, the size is fixed. 4K per page, let's say 16 bytes. Per pair of key and then a pointer, key and then a page number. It's two integers, about 16 bytes. So we're talking, you know, maybe somewhere on the order of 500 pages. 500 pages times 4K is about 10 megabytes of data. Sorry, 2 megabytes of data. Megabytes of data is not really huge data. We're going to run out of space in those nodes pretty fast. Any thoughts?
The distribution of the data is in such a way that each page contains a small range. Like the first page contains a lot of entries with page 1 and page 2. And the second page contains a lot of entries with page 3. So you'll read a lot of phases to actually store the start and endpoint instances?
Yeah, so you would basically need more than one page to store your separator values. And that would be true even if each page had a whole wide range of different versions. If I have more, 2 megs of data, if I have more than 2 megabytes of data values, I'm going to have more data than I can, more page IDs, or more separator values than I can conceivably store in one page of data. So I'm going to need more than one page to store my little summary. So now, in principle, I could take these summary pages, and I could do a binary search over those. But now, once again, I'm back to this problem of having to repeatedly do lookups of having to load in a ton more pages than I need. So what if I summarize the summary pages? So just like I have up here something that says this page of data values corresponds to ages between 1 and 23, while this page of data values corresponds to ages between 23 and 59. I could have something that says this page of summaries corresponds to values between 1 and 200. And this page of summaries corresponds to keys between 1 and, let's say, 400. So forth. Questions? Yeah.
Now we are going for age. Or let's say I just want to do it for another field in the table. That tool is followed on the indexing and the keeping track of all the starting and endpoint. So if I'm doing for several fields, what is the environment?
That is a fantastic observation. So the observation, to repeat it more loudly, is that this only works for age. And if we want to index another attribute, let's say the rank or the name, then we have to go through this whole process over again. And that's going to take more space. We need to get into this grudge match here, because you're going to we're going to have a showdown. But that is a fantastic observation, and you guys are reading my mind. I like this. You guys should be teaching the class. Save me. All right. So let's take a look at. So we've got this hierarchical structure. What we basically come up with here is one of the very first types of what are called index structures. So you've got your data. Your data is nicely organized. Has anyone ever used a card catalog? Okay, I didn't think so. Ages ago, we used to have these things called books, and these big buildings called libraries that you put the books in. Now, the libraries were huge. You generally didn't want to go through everything in the library to find the one book that you were looking for. So instead, they had these kind of little drawers where basically they had cards that summarized which books you had. A library index or library card catalog. This is basically doing something very similar. It tells you build this supplemental structure over your data that tells you where to look. And by looking through the index, it saves you time and effort when you actually want to access your data because you know exactly where the data is. All right. Updates next class. Let's get into this branch. Okay, so there have been a few. Any questions up to this point before I? Yeah. Oh, in the data page?
Yeah.
Yes and no. So we haven't addressed the question of changing data. So as of right now, we're assuming that your data is fixed, that you know all of your data up front, and you have time to build this structure over it. This, by the way, is what's called an index structured access method tree. Something you will never hear ever again. But basically, it's a structure designed for static data. There's a few kind of hacks to get it to work with data updates. We'll get into some of those next class. But for today, since all of your data is known up front, you don't actually have to worry about running out of space because you can just organize everything up front. I know that doesn't address your question, but does that successfully defer the question? Any other questions? Yeah.
What if we want to access all the records that has an age more than 20? In that case, we have to access more than two pages. So is that actually helping us in any way?
Ah, okay. Thank you for reminding me. One thing I did not catch. So is this helping us if we want to access all pages? If our selection predicate captures most of the data, but not all. That's a very good trade-off to point out that if your filtering condition, if the filtering predicate is what we call not selective enough, in other words, if it returns most of the data anyway, then the index might actually be hindering you, might slow you down, because now you have to load a bunch of index pages, as well as the data pages that you're returning all of your data from. In some cases, in the extreme, you might even just benefit from doing a full table scan rather than doing an index scan. That will come right back to haunt us at the start of March. Any other questions? Question is, how does this approach generalize? Or expanding on your comment there, how does this approach generalize? So we've already explored how to return a specific record. In a sense, what we've been looking for is how you return a specific record. And what I think you're getting at is how do you return, or how do you use this structure to return to satisfy other types of filtering conditions? So what types of conditions can we answer? So you just addressed how do you answer the question, the query page. So we've addressed age equals x. So what about age is greater than x, or equivalently age is greater than or equal to x. And so your suggestion is you do a binary search to find the first page. So you're saving yourself essentially everything that occurs to the left, or everything that occurs earlier, all of the preceding pages. Often a win, but not always. Scan all of the remaining records. What else can we do? So if we can do greater than, can we do less than? How would you do that? Scan the pages, speak up. Scan the pages up to that specific selected page. Okay. So here's a question. Do we even need the index in that case? Now, you're going to load the page eventually anyway, and basically just keep scanning until you hit the page where the record, the last record occurs, and as soon as you get to that page, you're done. If you're starting from the very beginning, so you load the first page, you return all of the records. You load the second page, you return all of the records. You load the third page, and the third page happens to be where the last record they can return is. Data. And let's say that I want to return everything, all ages less than 21. And let's say we have really, really large records, so we have one page per record. Think of there being a bunch of 18-year-old ensigns and a bunch of 19-year-old ensigns and so forth. So let's say, so if I want to find everything less than 22, three pages, I want to find everything strictly less than 22. Read in the first page, because I have to scan that. I return all of the records. I load in the second page. I get through about half of it, and I realize, okay, the last record. Oh, I see. So that would prevent you from reading in the next page. Got it. Okay. Yeah. Agreed. So you could potentially use the index. if the index was already in memory. If not, then loading in the index page might be worse than loading in just the next page of data. Good observation. Okay. I will add one last thing, and then so you can basically combine these two methods to do x is less than h is less than y. You want to combine, find the first page, you scan up until the last record that you're looking for. Okay, so for next class, I want you to think about two things. What problems do you run into if you start updating the data? And also relatedly, how might you address the problem of multiple attributes of interest? How would you deal with the fact that there are more than one attributes that you may want to ask questions about? We'll get back to all of that, starting with the grudge match, and then move to updates. All right, thanks.